You welcome to church for the benefit of those who are coming for the first time to our church. We've been following a series on faith, family, and finances. In the month of June, we started with faith. We find out what faith is and what faith is not. One of the things we did not tell you in the month of June is that the difference between faith, foolishness, and presumption. And one day, we're going to talk about the difference between faith, foolishness, and presumption. When is faith, when is it foolishness, and when is it presumption? You need to know the difference. Praise God. So we moved on to family, and we looked at all kinds of things about family. What do women really, really want? One man saw my post and said, Pedro, I thought you knew accounting and you knew international business. I didn't know, you know what women really, really want. I did tell him that I did not know what women want because thank God it was a woman that taught us what women really, really want. And the conclusion of the matter that women don't even know what they want. That was the conclusion. Then we looked at what do men want? What do men desperately want? Praise God. Or of course, we started just sitting by telling you the myths and the half-truths about marriage. What are the myths? What are the lies and the half-truths? You need to go and get some of those series. They are valuable for those who are coming for the first time. And today, we are going to kick off with the last strand of this tripod on finances. The Lord will give us understanding today in Jesus' name. The Lord will give us insight today in Jesus' name. If you are coming here thinking that Pastor Peter will tell you how you can, play Beth Niger and all of, and make money, you are in the wrong place. Ladies and gentlemen, have you found out how many of those companies are now existing? Beth Niger, Beth King, Naira Beth, Baba Jebu. Have you guys noticed it? They found out, sir. They found out during the lockdown, where a lot of people were crying and wailing, these men were smiling to the banks. They go and check that. And many people were betting their lives away, thinking that if I pay him one, I'll get two. That's not what I'm coming here to teach you. I'm not going to teach you how to do MMM. You guys, if you played MMM, Abby, don't be lying. You'll be looking straight. Nobody knows you. I told you in my former church, in the headquarters church, when I was there, God just gave me a word. Said, go and tell them to depart from it. So I came to the people and said, you, when people say you have played, God said you should stop. I had one sister, I went to the ladies and was complaining, what's Pastor Pedro doing now? This thing is making me money. Ladies and gentlemen, no more than 2 weeks after that word, the thing collapsed. Go and ask them. Those of them are here today. This is not hide and seek. I said, God just told me to tell you to stop. Of course, some people made money, but other people lost money. You know, in any pyramid scheme, there are those who are below the pyramids. Those who are at the bottom always loses. Go and check it out. And can I prophesy to you? It's going to come back again. In another name, in another form. Because there are always greedy people. Greedy people want to make money quickly. And guess what? They will lose it. And I hope you will not be one of them. So I'm forewarning you now that this is called MMM. Whatever, a new name will come. It may be KKK, SSK, whatever. A new name will come. And some people, there will be some Mugu.com who will follow. Are you following me? So if you are here for possibly give me now that's not what I'm going to look at the scriptures. And we're going to go to the man who is the richest man of all times. Some people have started to value the wealth of Solomon, and so Solomon had about 2 trillion. T to a trillion, not million, not billion, but trillion. If you see that kind of money, my brother, you will faint. If you see trillion, you will just faint, butcher. You know what trillion is? Not me, not B. How many zeros is in T? Who knows how many zeros in trillion? 12? No. Is it 12 billion or is it trillion? Okay. I need mathematician in the house. Who are the mathematicians in this house? Who knows? Come forward. You know mathematics. Come. I need somebody else to challenge him. Who knows mathematics? Come, sir. Come forward. Who knows mathematics in this house? One more person. Sister. I know sisters always know mathematics more than brothers. Who else knows mathematics? Only him. He's going to get the prize. There's money to be won. Who has mathematics? Come down. Your wife. Where's your wife now? She's not volunteering. Who knows mathematics here? Fear them. Fear them. You know maths. Michael, don't embarrass me. Oh. Come out if you know maths. Who knows mathematics in the house? Only one man. Sisters, go in.
Ebonlu Ashogalu, come out. My wife.
Come on, baby. Come. God bless. Come on, give her. God bless you, clap. Come on. Hallelujah. Praise God. So I've got some coins here. We have started the message. Hold this coin. What kind of coin is that one?
It's a 1 naira coin.
1 naira coin. Some of you have never seen 1 naira coin in your life before.
When was the last time you saw 1 naira coin? Anybody here? Very, very long ago. So one of the things I do when I travel around the world, I like to pick coins of the countries. But this is Nigerian naira. Okay? Now I'm going to give this lady another coin. Which coin is this one? That one is more valuable. 1 pound. She's holding a 1 pound coin. Please don't take it away. That coin is very valuable. Praise God. 1 pound is now how much? 700 naira. 700. Praise God. Okay, let's focus now. Sir, you know mathematics very well. You also know mathematics very well. Now, imagine you throw this coin up. And anytime you throw it up, it doubles. So you throw the first time, throw it up. Throw it up. Okay, when you throw it up, it doubles. So you now have two. Throw your coin up. You throw it up. Anytime you throw it up, you now have two. Now, every time you throw the coin up, when it comes down your hand, it doubles. Sir, how many times will you throw it up before you become a million? And you too. Quickly, do the maths. Anytime you throw the coin up, it doubles. So the first time you throw it up, it becomes two. You throw two up, it becomes what? Four. You throw four up, it becomes what? Eight. You throw eight up, it becomes what? 16. You throw 16 up, it becomes what? Go ahead. How many times? Eh? No, that's not true. It's not 500 times. It's simple duplication. We are telling you the principles of multiplying. How do you multiply your money? The first time I throw it up, 1 becomes 2. 2 becomes 4. 4 becomes 8. 8 becomes 16. 16 becomes 32. 32 becomes 64. 64 becomes 126. So how many times will I throw it up before I become 1 million? No, not 1,000 times. See. Not 500 times. Not 50 times. You are very close. Do you have a calculator? Come, my dear. God bless you. Give her God bless you. Come. God bless you. Come and use calculator now to solve it for us. See, maybe my coin back. You say you know mathematics. Mama's joke. So the first time becomes two. So two now becomes second time, isn't it? The first time I throw the coin up, it becomes two. Abi, so you now have two. Two times two. That's it. How many times now? Four times two. 8 times 2, 16 times 2, 32 times 2, 64 times 2, 128. 128 times 2, 256. 256 times 2, 512. 512 times 2, we have become a million. So how many times is that? 500, okay. Okay, go ahead, next time. 512 times 2. 1,024. How many times is that one now? Then next time now, continue to multiply it. Now the principle, go back, man. Go and sit down. God bless you. Go ahead and go at home. The principle is that if you have a coin and you throw the coin up and multiply it and keep on multiplying, after some time you're going to become a millionaire. Abi? Very simple mathematics. Whether it's geometric mathematics, arithmetic progression, or thou knowest the mass. I have the coin. You know the mass. Praise God. What is that teaching us this morning? You must start from where you are to get to where you want to become. Start from where you are to get to want to become. Some of people are waiting for the big 1 million to drop on their lap, but they're having the small right now. If you don't start from that small, you can never get the big. The principles of God says that we multiply what is in your hand. You have to multiply, you have to increase it. There has to be something in your hand for God to multiply and to increase. Are you following me? So don't just wait for the big one. I also found out in life that if you're not able to manage the small, you're not able to manage the big. If you cannot manage, that's one of the problems when they had the prodigal son. All of a sudden, he had this wealth with him. I didn't know what to do with it. Wow, this is too much. What do I do? He will misbehave. I made a mistake recently in life. There's a young boy that they asked me to mentor and to supervise. I thought the boy was matured. I said, okay, the guy looks reasonable. And he had about 30 million in his hand. Oh, that way you can manage. The guy looked mature. He was talking to me reasonably. Foolishly, I believe he was a mature guy. Until something happened, this guy was just spending the money. I have to, hey, stop! Put an alert on that account. Because I just found out he couldn't manage it. He couldn't manage it. So there's an issue with sudden wealth. You fall into wealth suddenly without growing the process of time, you will misbehave. It's called premature exposure. When people are prematurely exposed to things. Even the Lord God said, take Jesus, take the child, take him to Egypt, for his time has not yet come. All through scripture, the Bible talks about when was fullness of time, when the time was fully come. There's a full time. So some of you here looking at me with all due respect, if you were to hit $1 million today, you may not come to church tomorrow.
I'm telling you, I'm not talking of $1 million, I'm talking of $1 million. You say, what are we praying for again? Pastor Pedro, come to my house, come and pray. I want this special prayer, a special chapel in my house. You know, when I come to church, they'll be asking me for money, they'll be rubbing, So for some of you, God needs to take you through a time before $1 million comes to your hand. Praise God. The Lord will take us there in Jesus' name. Okay, so let's look at King Solomon, who is reputed to be the richest king that ever lived. Recently, I read about a man called Mansa Musa. I don't know if some of you have heard about Mansa Musa of the Mali Empire. He was so rich, he was going to pilgrimage in Saudi Arabia. He took his caravan and soldiers and bodyguards and slaves with him that went to Egypt. The value of gold devalued in Egypt. Went to Saudi Arabia and the way back, stopped over in Egypt and was trying to buy the gold back. He took so much money, so was so wealthy from Mali Empire. Now, a lot of people are estimating how much he was. I don't know what. Thank God it's not in the Bible. But when I look at the Bible, the richest man the Bible says ever lived is called King Solomon. King Solomon wrote the book of Proverbs and the book of Ecclesiastes. And he left for us secrets that we can glean at this morning and say, how I may not be as rich as Solomon, but what do I do? What did this man do? I always tell you, one of the things persons you learn from, the person who has made it or who has acquired it, who has it, or maybe someone who has lost it, to learn how not to lose it, or somebody who has it to learn how to have it. So we're looking at King Solomon this morning. So we're going to start from 2 Chronicles chapter 1. 2 Chronicles chapter 1. I will start from verse number 11. 2 Chronicles chapter 1. After Solomon has been crowned king, from verse 11, I will read the New Living Translation this morning. God said to Solomon, because your greatest desire is to help your people and you did not ask for wealth, riches, fame, or even the death of your enemies or long life, but rather you have asked for wisdom and knowledge to properly govern my people, I will certainly give you the wisdom and knowledge you requested. I, Lord, will give you the wisdom and the knowledge you requested, but I will also give you, I, God, will also give you wealth, riches, and fame, such as no other king had before you or will ever have in the future. So this is why I believe that Masamusa was not the richest. God said, I'm going to give you so much wealth, no king in the past and no king in the future. Not the Assyrian kings, not Queen Elizabeth of England, not Napoleon, none of those kings that ruled had as much wealth as Solomon. Because God says, in the past or the future, you are going to be the richest man that ever lived. So Solomon was a wealthy man, very wealthy, and he left for us insights about how we can maintain wealth, how we can grow wealth, and how we can manage wealth. The Lord will help us in the name of Jesus. I know this topic become quite uncomfortable for a lot of people. He said, Pastor, should we be talking about money in church? Should we be talking about money in church? Should we not leave money to Lagos Business School to talk about? Why are we talking about money in church? Bible says, my people perish for lack of knowledge, isn't it? He said, where there's no vision, the people do what? They perish. I also found out where there's no provision, the vision will die. So we need a provision to move the vision forward. Are you following me? Some ministries are stagnated because there's no money to do it. The preacher has a word. The word is hot in his mouth, but he doesn't have access to internet, doesn't have access to television, doesn't have access to the principal. The word will die there. I found out in the life of Jesus, there were certain women who were following him who were funding the ministry. Go and read your Bible. Luke chapter 8. The people were funding the ministry. Are you following me? So Pastor, let's talk about, no. Because some of you think that money will make you become a sinner. Money does not make you become a sinner. Money just reveals the sin in your heart. If you're already a sinner, when the money comes, the sin will come out. Are you following me? The last time I read my Bible, Abraham was a friend of God. Did you know that? And Abraham was a very rich man. The last time I read my Bible, Job was a friend of God. The Bible says Job was the wealthiest man in the East. Friend of God. Hello? I know some of you want to be Lazarus, who sits at the rich man's table in front of his gate begging. And when you are begging, guess what? Dogs will come and be licking your sores. And you only eat when the man eats. The day the man fasts, you fast. The day the man is eating, you are eating. You want this, the one that follows. I don't want to be a Lazarus. I want to be an Abraham. Friend of God. Praise God. Wealthy friend of God. Hallelujah. Are you following me? So throw away that mentality that poverty equals spirituality. Poverty does not equal spirituality. Oh, money can make your heart deceptive. There's danger of wealth. And that's why the first principle that Solomon tells us here is Ecclesiastes 5 verse 8 and Proverbs 10 22. That's the first principle that Solomon is telling us. Don't trust in wealth. Don't put your trust in money. Because money can grow wings and fly away. So the first principle, you see that trust in God, not in money. That's one lesson we learn. You see that in Proverbs 10, 22 and Ecclesiastes 5, verse number 8. Can we just project? Let's see that we can read that or I'll read it from my scripture. Proverbs 10, 22, Ecclesiastes 5, verse number 8. Let's look at Proverbs 10. Proverbs 10, 22. So your trust should not be in money. Your trust should be in the living God. Proverbs 10, 22. It says, the blessing of the Lord, he maketh rich, he add no sorrow unto it. The blessing of God is what you should depend upon. Ecclesiastes 5 verse 8 says, you should not trust on wealth because they will fly away. Number two principle we found, having known that God is the source of your wealth, God is the source of your increase, God is the source of your abundance. How did Solomon become rich? In that scripture we read earlier on, so God opened opportunity for Solomon. God says, Solomon, I'm going to give you wisdom. I'm going to give you a certain understanding that no man can withstand you. When I read my Bible, and I'm sure some of you have heard before, I found that Solomon had different sources of income. It's called multiple sources of income, or you call it multiple streams of income. I know people have gone to the book of Genesis and said, in the garden, the river parted into four ways. There are multiple streams, okay? So, but where is Solomon's multiple streams? So if you have your Bible, please turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 1 again. And I'll try to show you Solomon's multiple streams of income. That is why you tell me, Pastor, I'm a salary earner. Thank God for salaries. It doesn't matter where you work. There's a limit to what your salary can do. For some of you right now, you are living from paycheck to paycheck. If they were to delay the paycheck coming, you'll be in trouble. You'll be in trouble. In fact, some of you, if you lose your job, after 1 month, some of you are already scattered. After 1 month. Some of you will last 3 months before you become scattered. Some of you, 6 months. Now, if you lose your job and you cannot survive 6 months, you are in trouble. If you lose your job and you don't have enough to take you for 6 months, you are not all right. You're financially not balanced. Are you following me? This message is for you. Better listen with all rapt attention. If they sack you today, 6 months. If they sack you today, follow you, you're in trouble. Ah, manga. You know, in the light, you have red, amber, and you are red. Danger. Walk on it. Are you following me? Some of you have just been looking straight. Nobody knows you are talking about. Just be looking straight. Hallelujah. I said, praise God. Have you found 2 Chronicles chapter 9? 2 Chronicles chapter 9. From verse 13 to 24, as you glean those scriptures, discover that Solomon had four sources of revenue that were coming to him. Most of us here have one source. 30 days, make it pay. What we need to do today is that, Lord, open my eyes to potentially other sources of revenue that will be coming in. Yesterday, when at our prayer meeting, one of the prayer points we prayed that God grant me capacity. Are you following me? We also prayed, God grant me wisdom. The book of Job says that the spirit that works in the man, but the inspiration of the Lord grants them understanding. What can I do to diversify my source of revenue so that I have continuous flow? So where one is coming, the other one is also coming. The various types are coming. I'm not waiting every day. Now, there's a sister here who just wrote a book. Sister Doe is in church. God bless you. This was something she had in her spirit, and she just put it in a book. This is a potential source of income. It's a pastor book. Ah, okay. She's selling for 1,000 naira. I'm helping her to advertise it for free. She's not paying me royalty for that. Okay? That's a potential source of income. So, some of you are gifted in book writing. Some of you, you can sing. Some of you can do part-time teaching. You know that the guy who was coming to teach my children French, I was paying the guy 5,000 naira per hour. Because I wanted my son to have an A in French. 5,000 naira per hour. That's what the man was charging. Okay, take it or leave it. And the people were struggling for him. So it was a matter of, you know, when there's scarcity, the price goes up, isn't it? 5,000 naira per hour. French teacher. Bonjour. Ça va. Très bien. So I told him, if this guy doesn't have an A, you give me back my money. Of course, the boy has to by force. Praise God. So what to you can be a potential source beside what you are doing now that will not cause a distraction to your work? Some of you call it side hustle. You need to review your side hustle. That will not cause distraction. I'm not saying go and be taking your boss's time. I'm stealing their time. I'm stealing their pencil. No, that's what I'm asking you. What can I do that will not interfere with my day-to-day work? Praise God. I said, praise the Lord. Maybe some of you have a car. You're sitting in your garage. Is it time to turn into an Uber? Weekend Uber driver. Say, Pastor, I'm a big boy. I hear some Uber, executive Uber. Turn your car to executive Uber. They call you, you pick them, they pay you. Nobody, money not the smell for body. I hope you know that. They will not know. So Solomon had four sources of income that were coming to him. Number one source of income that Solomon had tributes that people were paying to him. Verse 13, 2 Chronicles 9, verse 13, the weight of gold that Solomon received yearly was 666 talents, not including the revenues brought in by the merchants and traders. So Solomon was receiving weight of gold, 66 talents every year as tributes. In addition to that, number two, Solomon had traders. People were trading for him. They were buying and selling goods on behalf of Solomon. So the first thing was a tribute, the kings that were subject to him. Oga, this is our tribute to you. May you live long. Oba, Dokbe, long live the king. One. Number two, he had men who were trading for him. 2 Chronicles chapter 1, verse 16 to 17 talks about people were trading horses for him. 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 21 says that people were buying and selling things on behalf of Solomon. He had trading ships. Look at verse 21, where we are, chapter 9, verse 21. The king had a fleet of trading ships manned by Hiram servants. Once every 3 years, he returned carrying gold, silver, ivory, apes, and baboons. NIV. Now let's go to chapter 1 and you see also what they were doing. He had people who were trading on his behalf. Chapter 1, verse 16 to 17. Write it down quickly. Solomon's horses were imported. Solomon's horses were imported from Egypt and from Kuwait. The royal merchants purchased them from Kuwait at the current price. They bought them at the price and they sold them to other kings around. So Solomon was not just getting only tributes. It was hard men who were trading. They were doing what? Importing and exporting. In between, there was a margin. He buys them from Egypt. He sells them to the other kings around. That's another source of income that Solomon had. So when I heard that Solomon was rich, this man said, so if Solomon can be buying and selling, you, what are you buying and selling? You know, when I came to Aja, I found out that water in Aja and water on the mainland is not the same price. Did you people know that before? So what are you doing? You go to the mainland every day. You carry empty car, blow back. I say, that's what they do. My water comes from mainland. Don't let them hear. I buy my water from the mainland. I don't buy water in Aja. You think that's so expensive here. I buy my water from the mainland. The water I drink in my office, mainland water. Tell me, Pastor, you're not tush. You need island water. What's the difference? Solomon was a trader, importing and... Number three, I found out that Solomon had gifts that people were giving him. Became wealthy by the reason of gifts. You remember the woman called Queen Sheba? Came to greet Solomon. She brought a lot of things. A lot of people were bringing things. They were just bringing things to Solomon. So number one, he had tributes. Number two, he had trading. Number three, he had gifts that people were giving to him. Number four, Solomon, because he was king, of course, had taxes. So at least four sources of income that Solomon had. How many sources do you have? Ladies and gentlemen, like I said before, if you have only one source, your potential of becoming rich is very, very limited. Very, very limited. Sorry to say. Pastor, what do I do? Remember the story of the coin? What do you start? You start now. Because some of you, you are too big, you don't want to start small. Bible says, don't despise the days of what? Thank you. That must be days of little beginning. Don't despise it. You have school, maybe I'm just doing crèche. From crèche, I go to primary. From primary, I go to secondary. From secondary, I go to A-levels. From A-levels, I go to university. But start. Because you know, pastor, know that. That's who I am. And it's on the big. And it's on the big. Okay, praise God. It will come in Jesus' name. So, number one principle, Solomon trusted in God. Number two, he had multiple streams of income that were coming in with. Number three, very close to that, Solomon says in Ecclesiastes 11 that you should learn to diversify. Let's see Ecclesiastes 11, verse number 1 to 3. I like the King James, but sometimes when we read the King James of Ecclesiastes 11, we are a bit worried because it doesn't come out clear. King James of Ecclesiastes 11, from 1 to 3, it says, cast your bread upon the waters. And after many days, you will do what? You will find it. Have you read that before? Cast your bread upon the waters, for thou shalt find it after many days. So when I read this Bible, I ask myself, which bread? Agege bread or Lekki bread? Should I cast upon the waters? Which bread is the Bible talking about here now? Cast your bread upon the waters. If I cast my bread upon the water, will not become swollen. So, of course, you have to understand that this was like a parable. He was not talking about physical loaf of bread. Agege bread, you cast up. Because when you cast agege bread upon water, it will swell up. So, what actually the scripture was talking about the seed. There's a seed you must sow. There's a seed you will sow. There's a seed you sow. So, if you read our translation, it gives you some insight into what this scripture is saying. So, I like what the New Living Translation put it. It says, send your grain across the seas, and in time, profit will flow back to you. Wow. So I thought, what any places? So one of the second principle or top principle is that don't put all your eggs in one basket. You must learn to diversify your portfolio. I've seen a lot of people, and I don't know why, for one reason or the other, that the market in Lagos get burnt regularly. I don't know why markets in Lagos. Have you noticed markets are getting burnt? So you hear some men say, Pastor, I am the owner of all these shops on this line. All these shops on this line belong to me. That's a dangerous thing to do. To own all the shops in this line. My Igbo brother talked about that. I'm the owner of all the shops in this line. That's a dangerous thing to do. And if you look at the guy has no insurance on the line. If you notice, Yaba markets got burnt, Abi. The one in CMS, why is it getting burnt? Is it on spiritual forces? Or because people are just, the way they do things, everybody, you have generator, everybody has generator. So you are setting yourself up for getting burnt. So Solomon says, diversify your investment. Don't go and buy the land in the whole street. I'm dealing on this street. The day you now find out that the CFO you have is fake CFO, government says that area has been acquired. What have you done? You lose everything. So Solomon says, guys, you must have seven or eight portfolio of investment. Even before we got to now, found out in business management that the ideal portfolio to have is actually seven or eight. Solomon has said before in the scripture, must have seven or eight. He said, diversify yourself, have seven or eight types of investments that you must have. I met a man once on this part of Lagos who said, Pastor, me, I don't keep cash at home. All I have is land. I have land everywhere. You say, wow, thank God for this man. But that's the wrong investment type. So all you have is land. No cash, nothing else, land. No. Thank God for land. God, somebody say, God is not creating new land, isn't it? So land is scarce. So you become rich having land. But that's the wrong type based on Solomon's advice here. And this is the richest man that ever lived, telling you, have seven types of investments. So if you have land, property, praise God. You have stocks and shares, praise God. You have all kinds, you are invested in gold or in art, praise God. Or you have royalties coming to you, you must have seven types where flows are coming from. Praise the Lord. So diversify your what to, and please, don't go and say, because Pastor Pedro, I've said it now. Ha, Pastor, you say we should diversify. I'm spreading my own. I have 20 types of investment. And each of those investments, they are seasick. They are doing like this. Yoruba people also have a proverb. They say, if you want to wee-wee, we win once for all, you can foam. So ensure that the investment are solid themselves. Not, I have one primary school is still doing like this. The primary school is doing like that. And I have one secondary school. I don't want to do like this. They are not standing. So let it be solid. That's why I say seven. So they are strong in themselves to have an impact. Hello? And we can go into details some other times about this. But King Solomon told us here that we should divide your investment among many places, for you do not know what risk it might lie ahead of you. So there are risks. Recently, some young boys and young men, people are now doing what they call cryptocurrency. I must confess, I don't know anything about cryptocurrency. I'm not invested in cryptocurrency. But don't put all your money in cryptocurrency. Say, pastor, it's crypto. Okay, praise God for crypto. Crypto also can go up and down, and it has gone up and down. So learn to spread your investment. Have an investment portfolio. Hallelujah. Number four, thing we learn from Solomon. Solomon tells us in Ecclesiastes 11, verse 4 to 6, what wisdom do we learn from this man? From verse 4 to 6, he said, plant your seed. No, let me look from verse 4. He said, farmers who wait, I'm reading New Living Translation. Says, farmers who wait for the perfect weather never plant. Farmers who wait for the perfect weather never plant. He said, if you watch every cloud, you will never harvest. Just as you do not understand the path of the wind or the mystery of the tiny baby growing in the mother's womb, so you cannot understand the activity of God who does all things. Plant your seed in the morning and keep busy all the noon, for you don't know if your profit will come from one activity or another, or maybe both. King James says, in the morning sow the seed, and in the evening withhold not the hand, for thou knowest not whether thou shalt prosper, whether this or that, or they both shall be alike. What is it saying here? There's a risk involved in business. There's a risk involved in every investment. Pastor, I want a risk-free investment. Even when you buy what they call treasury bills, which is government bills, Abi, Afghanistan, there's Afghanistan bills. I don't know if anybody was holding you know where Afghanistan is? People are looking at me. Wave your hand if you know Afghanistan. If you heard of the country, Abi, you know they've just, Taliban just taken over. So if you were holding an Afghanistan treasury bill, what will happen to that Afghanistan treasury bill now? Okay, so what I'm saying is that even the most secured government can fail. So there's a risk in every investment portfolio. For some of you are so risk adverse, the money you are making, you are putting under your bed and sleeping on top of it, so it can be safe and secured. Say, pastor, bank can fail. I don't want to put my money in bank. Okay, put your money under your bed now. Bed can catch fire, and if you go out, somebody can come and steal the money. So there's a risk in every investment. So don't be so risk adverse that you don't want to do anything. Somebody says the biggest risk is not doing anything at all. That's the biggest risk. So, but calculate your risk, ensure you well-measured risk, and then go ahead and go for it. The Lord will bless you and keep you in the name of Jesus. I'll take two more before we close, because I know time is fast against us, and I want us to finish today, or if we're not finished today, some other time we'll continue on this. So there's a risk in investment. So please don't, while you have done all the calculations, don't over-calculate. Some people are so paralyzed by analysis. It's called analysis paralysis. They analyze, and they do nothing. Tell your neighbor, go for it. You have analyzed it, you've calculated it, you've secured it. You say, hey, pastor, what if? There is no business without a risk. I'm telling you, in my own life, I found out you do something, whoosh, it works. Sometimes it doesn't work. Even after you're praying, say, this didn't work. I tell some people, I said, the easiest way to become a millionaire is by the calculator. How do you say so? You know, if you are calculating, pastor, if we just buy land in Lekki Free Trade Zone, we wait, you just calculate, it will sell like this. Praise God. All the landowners in the house. You know, you just calculate, Abi. You see the profit by calculator. Does it come like that? When you now want to sell the land, the agent says, I must collect 10%. The other person says, my money. Calculator can deceive you. Just calculate the millions. So there's a risk in every investment. But that does not stop us, or should not stop us, from going further. So he says, he that sows, watches the wind, will never sow. That will not be your portion
in the name of Jesus. Number five, Solomon tells us there is power in walking in teams. Ecclesiastes chapter 4. There is power when you walk in teams. Someone says, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go with others. If you want to go fast, go by yourself. But if you want to go far, you must go with others. Ecclesiastes 4, verse 9 to 12. Let me read from the King James. Ecclesiastes 4, from verse 9. Say, two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fail, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him that is alone when he fails. You know, anytime we read this scripture, what comes to our mind is marriage, isn't it? That's what comes to our mind. Two are better than one. Okay? Praise God. But woe to him that is alone when he fails, for who has no one to help him. Verse 11. Again, if two lie together, they keep warm. But who can be warm all by himself? Though one may overpower by another, two can withstand him. And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. There is power in working in teams. There is power when you aggregate resources and do things together. One of the problems I found in church and in Nigeria also is that we like to run things all by ourselves. I want to be MD, CEO, president, and founder. Everybody has a card. They are president, founder, CEO, managing director, chairman. I say, what's wrong with pulling resources together? What's wrong with pulling resources together? And pastor, if we pull resources together, we'll be MD. Why does that matter? Praise God. There's a certain mindset we need to change. Working together in team, pulling resources together. That man want to buy land. He doesn't have the full money, he has half. The other man too want to buy land. He doesn't have money, he has half. Okay, bros, why don't both of you come together and buy the land? And pastor, who will be in control? That's the problem we have. Control. So Solomon says, when you work together as a team, you are able to achieve much more. The Lord will help us to do that in Jesus' name. So whether you want to form a company or you want to have partnership, learn to work with other people so that you can achieve the result you want. Number six, lesson we learn from Solomon, Ecclesiastes 10 verse 10. Ecclesiastes 10 verse number 10. Hallelujah. I said, praise God. Are you still here? Ecclesiastes 10 verse 10. We're learning from the man, the richest man that ever lived. He says, if an iron be blunt, he that will wet it and will wet the air, then must you put on more strength. But wisdom is profitable. Let me read my New Living Translation. Listen to me carefully. Because this is a lesson you need to learn. He says, using a dull axe, an axe that is dull, requires great strength. So sharpen the blade. That's the value of wisdom. It helps you to succeed. What is the lesson here? Hard work does not lead to money. Are you following me? Pastor, what do you mean? If hard work leads to money, the man carrying pompon will be the richest man in Lagos. What leads to money then? Smart work leads to money. Are you following me? Not hard work. Hey, pastor, I'm a hard working man. Praise God for you. The ass is dull. Because the ass is dull, what are you doing? But imagine if you just go and sharpen the axe. Praise God. Or if you go and buy a machine to cut the tree, what will you do? Hello? So hard work is not equal to more money. But imagine combining smart work with some work. Smart work, you are working smartly. Leads to wealth. So what we are talking about this morning here, thank God for those of you who have been working very hard. Praise God for your hard work. Continue to work hard. But can you add some wisdom to your work and see whether profitability will not come? Recently, one brother was telling me how somebody based in Nigeria, is teaching his daughter in America how to code. Hello? The body is in Nigeria, teaching his daughter in America how to code. Through what, sir?
Thank you. So I said, wow. All the teachers in Nigeria, where are you people? What are you doing? Teachers in my church, why are you not setting up an internet system so I can be teaching children in London, in America, how to solve mathematics, how to do coding? What, how would they be paying you? And how much is dollar now? Thank you. The same amount of time you have. Apply that time. Just buy a laptop, buy advertise yourself on the internet. Praise God. And then, bros, I told you to go to the ground. Dollar. When you come to church, even Pastor Pedro will feel it. I just told you the story of the guy who was calling 5,000 naira for French. 5,000. The man doesn't work in any school anymore. Because he's going from house to house, let's say 5,000 naira per hour. So I told myself, if you were coming, you better start. Don't be playing. Daddy, you cannot come. Immediately start. Because the guy is counting the. If you like, if I come, you go and say, let me watch TV. Time is going. I'll be watching TV. How are you, Junior? Continue to watch TV. Please sign the hours I spend with you. So wisdom is important. So whatever business we are saying, thank God this is the age of technology. How can technology help me to give speed to my business? My wife is here. There's a product she imported about 2 or 3 years ago. The thing was sitting in our house like that. She was going up and down looking for who to sell it. She was going up and down looking for who to sell it. She was, we sell one today, sell another one today. This thing was sitting down. Recently, somebody told her how to put this thing into Jumia. Is it Jumia you call it? They log it in. My brother, my order has come. Another order has come. Jumia, This thing has been in my house since. We have prayed. We have laid hands. Technology, just, because with Jumia, what are you not selling? You are selling to the whole Nigeria, at least. People are bought from Jaws, from Port Harcourt. People are, this is that will help. Because you are running up and down to everywhere in Lagos. But all of a sudden, your world opens up. So what is your business? Can you open up to the world? Can you take that your skill and sell it to the world? By reason of wisdom. Thank God for hard labor, hard labor. Bible saying, if your axe be blunt, the amount of power you will apply to it will be much. The Lord will grant us wisdom in the name of Jesus. You know, people always ask the question, how does God bless people? How does God bless people? Father, I pray for blessing. Is God going to open the windows of heaven and pour me out money? I found out one of the ways God blesses people is to give you an idea. God gives you an idea. Are you following me? God gives you an idea that works. A business idea that works. Boom. Because some of us, the prayer, when we are praying, God bless me, God bless me, you are actually in your mind thinking that you go to an ATM without no money in your account, you put your ATM in it, you press the number, and money come out. Because some of you are going to those churches where you say, ATM by fire. Fire! Oh, a lot. Oh, he also has gone to another church where the pastor prays and a lot enters into your account. I don't have that anointing here. I must confess. I don't have that anointing to pray and fire and money enters into your account. Are you following me? Because I'm asking myself, where is the money coming from? There has to be a debit and credit. If you have a credit alert, where did the debit go to? Heaven's account. That means heaven has an account with one bank. But what I found that works in my life, God gives you an idea. Guess what? I also found out that God gives you connection. God connects you with people. Are you following me? That tells you about something. That connection becomes a source of wealth. There's a guy I met a few years ago, and we started talking. Before you know, he said, Pedro, if you do this for me, I give you 5%. When I calculated my 5%, my God, there was a smile on my face. Connection, contact, ideas, opportunities come your way. And that's my heart prayer for every one of you this morning, that God will give you an idea in the name of Jesus. God will connect you to the right people in the name of Jesus. God will give you the right opportunity in the name of Jesus. And when those things come, you will not be afraid to take the step required in the name of Jesus. I say, praise God. So if the axe be blunt, you must do much more than you are doing right now. So while you are working hard, please remember to walk smartly in the name of Jesus. I say, praise God. One more before I close. See about 4 or 5, but I think time is against us. One more before you close. And this is very important. Very, very important. Last week, I think we started on that to say, please don't spend all that you earn. I don't know for those of you in church, don't spend all that you are making right now. I know some of you are in a situation where you are spending more than you are earning. And therefore, you are in huge debt. What we call consumer debt. That is dangerous for you. But don't spend more than you are earning. And we'll see that in Proverbs 21 verse 20. Because your investment that we talk about is going to come out of the savings you have. The money to invest in that deal, in that transaction, come out from the money you have. If you don't have, when an opportunity comes, you will not be able to take advantage of it. So we say, bros, come. That man, he wants to sell his house. That house is 1 million. Your man will just say, give me anything. Anything like, give me 100,000. And you check, no 100,000. Will you take opportunity? So even if God bring the opportunity, you say, this is for you. I want to bless you. That it costs 1 million. Just give 100,000. You don't have. So the investment is coming out of a savings that you have. So you must learn and thank God for what you have right now. That opportunity for you to save, so that when an opportunity to invest comes, you can invest. Now Joseph explained this principle for us very, very clearly in the book of Genesis chapter 41. Genesis 41, Bible says there was a king called Pharaoh who dreamt a dream. And the dream was a scary dream. He dreamt that there were some animals that were fat. 7 of them or so. And he now dreamt another animal that were slim. 7 of them. And the slim animals went after the fat animals and ate them up. And he didn't understand, what does that mean? You remember the story of Genesis 41? And he wanted to say, Joseph now came, okay? They brought Joseph out of prison. Please come and interpret for us, what does this dream mean? How can the slim animals eat up the big animals? Say, let me tell you, sir. You are going to have 7 years of prosperity. Anybody here this morning who's less than 50 years, you are in your 7 years of prosperity. Let me say that again. If you are here this morning and you are less than 50 years old, you are in your 7 years of prosperity. Hello? Your 7 years of drought is coming. You know, when I say that, people don't like that thing. You don't like me to be saying that kind of thing. I know you're keeping quiet. If you are less than 50 years old, you are in your 7 years of prosperity. Can I say that again? If you are less than 50, your 7 years of drought is coming. So what should you do in your 7 years of prosperity? Rest, okay? Joseph told the king, these 7 years, look for a sharp man, a wise man. 20% of all of your current money until you are grain, keep them in a store. So when the 7 years of drought comes, you will feed on that thing. When I did my mathematics, 20 times 7 was 140. There's a more kind of reserve you keep. If you go back and read that story, the land of Egypt ran into poverty. I hope you know, remember the story. People were selling everything to the king. My land, my wife, my children. They sell everything. So even if that king was not rich, that king became the richest king then. Because everybody sold everything. He didn't have anything. So every man here, every woman here, you have your 7 years of prosperity. When you are working. When you are earning. Now because a lot of us who have become old, we think that our children will take care of us. Unfortunately, some of us here are not taking care of our own parents. So clearly, guess what will happen to you? Your children will not take care of you. You know, a curse. It's just a thing of life. So in your 7 years of prosperity, you need to be laying aside. What are you laying aside now? What are you laying aside? When say, pastor, I'm just spending everything, money will come to flow. Money will not continue to flow forever. There must be that 7 years. And that wisdom is called the Joseph formula. So for you, maybe what you need to put aside every month, apart from paying your tithe and your offering, 10% towards my future. 20% towards my future. If you do that consistently, like that coin that was going up, it will multiply. It will multiply. But some of us say, no. Nothing like that. Don't worry. What's going to be is going to be. What goes up must come down. What's going up? No. There's something God says, He said, with all your getting, get understanding. That's wisdom is profitable to direct. You must be putting that aside now consistently. Thank God for the federal government. They come up with a law that says if you are working in a place, you have a pension. You have to, Abi? But some people say, no, I don't want. I want my money now. Give me now. Ah, put this aside. So some people even wise, whether than that, over and above what the government is legislating, they add to it because that becomes tax-free. I'm not going to go into details this morning, but whatever you add to that, it's called an additional voluntary contribution. Whatever you add to that contribution is tax-free. And tax can chop your money. So if you can legally avoid tax, praise God. But you must have something for the future. Don't say, don't worry, my children will take care of me. My children, because your son just got married, Oyibo. Married Oyibo. Say, babe, mom, how are you, mom? Grandma, how are you doing, grandma? Abi? Now, read one chance. When you say, don't you, my son, you don't remember me, mama? Mumbo, Joe, mumbo. Because don't forget, at that time, their own pastor was telling them, take care of your children, take care of your immediate. So you cannot use your children as your insurance plan or your retirement plan. I'm talking to those who are less than 50 here. For those of us who are above 50, we are in God's hand now. We have to trust God. Lord, in my old age, take care of me. But for those of you much younger, you still have time. Anybody here, listen to me this morning, listen to me carefully, because I'm going to close now. Anybody here this morning who is listening to what I'm saying, and you are less than 30 years old, can I see your hand above your head? You are less than 30 years old. You have no reason to be poor when you grow old. Anybody, and the reason why I'm using that word, because there's a factor of time in making money. There's a factor of time. Do you remember the coin I was showing up? You know how many times the coin has to go up? There's a time. That's what I'm saying. Those who also are less than 30. If you're less than 30, you're less than 35, and you apply these principles I'm talking to you this morning, diligently, consistently, you have no reason to stand here when you are 50 and be poor. Lila, you cannot be. It doesn't matter how much you are earning now. You have enough to take care of yourself. You have enough. Well, for those of us who are 50, what can you do? There's a God who can intervene. Amen. I am the pastor. I cannot forget that there's a God who can intervene. That's why when Caleb says, Joshua, let me tell you, I'm strong now as I was before. Give me this mountain. God can intervene. Connie Sanders, who started the Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC, was 60-something when he started it. So it's not too late. But I'm just saying, on the process of natural laws, those of you who are younger have better chances than those of us who have crossed the 50 mark. Praise God. As I praise God. We have not finished. We're going to probably continue next week. God will help us. I know next week we're having friends of guests. I'm not sure. I'm struggling in my mind. Do I teach this next week? Do I continue? Or do I do something else? But I see more to learn. Those of you who play Baba Jebu, stop playing Baba Jebu. Bet Naija, Naija.com, Naira Bet. What are the names? Who play? You know, you are looking back. It's all told on you can't make money that way. The odds are against you. The odds are against you. You can't make money that way. Those men who are doing that thing, they're businessmen. I hope you know. Hallelujah. Let's rise up on our feet this morning. Let's rise up on our feet. Time is fast gone. There's still more to say. But say, Lord, thank you for wisdom. Help me to apply my heart to wisdom. Pray for yourself. Lord, help me to apply my heart to wisdom. Lord, grant me opportunity. Pray for yourself. Grant me opportunity, Lord. Grant me opportunity. Grant me ideas. Pray for yourself this morning. Ideas that will help you to break forth on the right and break forth on the left.